You will never run away, you're by my side.
Everybody hurts sometimes, I know that's what they say. But right now it seems this loneliness won't go away. Can anybody feel this heartache? Is anyone around? Feels like we're running round in circles, we can't catch a breath. We can't enjoy the moment when we always want what's next. Just when I can't take no more, it's when I hear you say,
don't hang your head when you get lonely. Never leave your side. And don't go thinking you're the only one that can get it right. Yeah, you got my low, 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 low down in your soul. Yeah, you got my low, 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 and I won't let you go.
I know there's nowhere I can run, there's nowhere I can hide from the one who gave his life so I could get back mine. So when you can't take no more, look up and hear him say,
don't hang your head when you get lonely. No, I'll never leave your side. And don't go thinking you're the only one that can get it right. Yeah, you got my low, 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 low down in your soul. Yeah, you got my new every morning.
Your grace sustains all of my life. You are the one that I run to. In you I am satisfied. Oh, your mercy is new every morning. Your grace sustains all of my life. You are the one that I run to. In you I am satisfied. Don't hang your head when you get lonely. No, I'll never leave your side. And don't go thinking you're the only one that can get it right. Yeah, you got my love, 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 love down in your soul. Yeah, you got my love, 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 and I won't let you go.
My weakest moment, I see you shaking your head in disgrace. I can read the disappointment written all over your face. Here come those whispers in my ear saying, who do you think you are? Looks like you're on your own from here. Grace could never reach that far. But
in the shadow of that shame, beat down by all the blame, I hear you call my name, saying it's not over. And my heart starts to beat so loud now, drowning out the doubt. I'm down but I'm not out.
There's a
floods a thirsty soul. The broken side begins to heal, and grace returns what guilty stole.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all here in worship this morning. Hard to believe we're a couple weeks into January already. A couple of announcements in your bulletin I'll draw your attention to. Really just Wii Soccer. Want to highlight that one. It's coming up here in February, and Karen is looking for coaches and lesson teachers and all kinds of volunteers. They're all kind of described here in your bulletin. And there's a little place on the Connect card if you're interested in helping out. You can just fill that out. Let us know. We'll let Karen know. She is on retreat this morning with our middle schoolers. God bless her and all the other volunteers. There's a reason God never called me to be a youth pastor. And middle schoolers are part of it. But I'm grateful that there are people here in our congregation who love on our kids. We've got two of them who are there right now. So anyway, That's the announcement. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to jump right in to worship this morning. We're going to start off singing "The Battle Belongs." To God. Amen. 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 All right. At this time, I'm going to invite our ushers to come. And as they come, we have an opportunity to give back to God a portion of what He's given to us. As part of our worship this morning, God has been so good in blessing us, and we want to join Him in the work that He's doing. And so you have the opportunity to do that by giving this morning. And the offering goes to support all the ministries and the missions and stuff that we partner with and are a part of. And you can throw your connect cards in the offering plate as it comes by as well. And as the ushers come, the worship team is going to lead us in probably a new one to most of you. So if you don't know it and you want to just listen, that's okay. But this song is called You've Already Won.
Overcome. Do something a little different today. Usually Pastor comes up and does our little prayer. So today we're going to go right into something else. So if you could, and you're willing and able, please stand and sing with us.
Let's pray together. God, we stand here before you this morning to seek your face. We come into your presence this morning, God, to worship you and to lift you up because we know that you are the only one who's worthy. So, God, we pray that this morning, as we've gathered here in your presence, as we've opened our hearts to what you want to say, God, that you would come and speak to us. We're grateful for the way that you continue to work in our lives, God, shaping us and molding us into the image of Jesus. Would you continue that work so we can be the people of God that you've called us to be? Would you continue to show us who you are? Because God, as grateful as we are for the great things you've done, the good things you've done, we're even more grateful, God, for who you are. Because we know that all that you do flows out of who you are. And so we thank you, God, for your holiness, your goodness, your faithfulness, your righteousness, your justice, your mercy, your compassion, your loving kindness. God, we are so grateful that you are good. And that you walk with us, you lead us, you guide us. And so we pray this morning that even though there are things swirling around us in each of our lives and our families, you would help us to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. And so, God, we continue to offer ourselves this morning as living sacrifices in response to you, the one who gave yourself for us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
To you, Lord, I'm gonna see.
seated. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Good morning. Today's scripture comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. Bear with me on the names. After this, the Moabites and Ammonites, and with some of the Meunites, came to make war upon Jehoshaphat. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is, En Gedi." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and the Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, "O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, 'If calamity comes upon us, whether by the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us.' But now here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt, so they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." All the men of Judah with their wives and children and little ones stood before the Lord. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel, son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite and descendant of Asaph, as he stood in the assembly. He said, "Listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, march down against them. They will be climbing up by the pass of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the gorge in the desert of Jeruel. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. All right, our kids are invited to head to junior church. Have you ever paid attention to the ways that our bodies and our emotions and our spirits are connected? You know what I'm talking about? When, like, you need to have a difficult conversation with someone, your stomach gets all knotted up. You walk into a comfortable, familiar place, maybe your home, hopefully your home, and you just feel your shoulders kind of drop and relax. You start to get a cold, and your body begins to ache, and your spirit begins to droop too. Right? You feel a sense of exhilaration or danger, and your heart begins to pound in your chest. Your senses go on high alert. Right? There's a reason that all of this happens, and all of this is true. And the reason is that no matter how hard we try, we can't separate our body from our spirit, right? Humans were designed as unified beings. We're not bodies that happen to have souls or souls that happen to have bodies. We are embodied souls. And so the things that we experience emotionally and mentally and spiritually, they make a difference to our bodies. But equally true is that the things that we do with our bodies matter to us spiritually. See, there's nothing that we do that's purely spiritual, right? And the goal of Christianity has never been to somehow get free of this flesh and bones, or to somehow leave behind this material world for some kind of disembodied heaven. But neither is there anything in life that's purely physical, right? The things we take into our bodies matter. The food we drink, the food we eat, the things we drink, the drugs we take, right? Prescription or otherwise. What we do with our bodies matters, right? Getting enough sleep, proper exercise and activity, who we sleep with, right? Because sex is never just sex. Our bodies matter because we are unified beings. We're embodied souls. Remember what Jesus said about the greatest commandment when he was asked about that? Right? He said to love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, right? No. He said, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, your body too. To love God completely with everything we are, and that includes our bodies. This is why I believe that we are still called to fasting. And I want to look at this scripture passage that Will read for us this morning. Didn't he do a great job with all those names? I told him I'd give him a little tutoring session ahead of time if he needed it, but he nailed it. So, but I want to look at this scripture passage that Will read for us this morning as one example of fasting in the Bible. To begin our conversation about what fasting is and why it matters. And I'll give you a hint here at the early part of my message. Fasting matters because what we do with our bodies matters. In this story that comes from 2 Chronicles, we find a coalition of nations have come against Judah with their armies. Judah being that southern half of the nation of Israel, or what was the nation of Israel under David and Solomon, but they'd split following Solomon's reign. So these nations, the Moabites, the Ammonites, the Meunites, they come against the nation of Judah. 2 Chronicles says a vast army came against them. And let's face it, right? Anytime you're outnumbered in a fight 3-1, you're not in a good spot, are you? So Jehoshaphat hears about all this, and rightfully so, he's alarmed. It's cause for concern. But immediately, the first thing he does, Jehoshaphat, the story tells us, resolves to ask God what they should do. And that checks out with what we know about Jehoshaphat. If we had been reading through the book of 2 Chronicles, in chapter 17, we would have read this description of Jehoshaphat. It said, the Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he followed the ways of his father David before him. He did not consult the Baals, but sought the God of his fathers and followed his commands rather than the practices of Israel. Now, normally we think of Israel as the good guys, right? But at that time, the northern tribe of Israel, they've fallen into idolatry. They're being led astray and worshiping false gods. And here in Judah, down here in the south, things have been a little more up and down, right? There have been some good kings that have led them to worship Yahweh, the God of Israel, but there have also been some bad kings that have led them into idolatry. Important point for this morning, Jehoshaphat, good king, okay? Jehoshaphat was a good king. And so Jehoshaphat determines that they're going to seek God's guidance about how to respond to this joint army. And he calls the people throughout the kingdom to a fast. And they gather together to ask God's wisdom. You've got people coming from all over the kingdom. They're fasting, and they're praying. And then Jehoshaphat, like the good king that he was, he leads them in prayer. And in this prayer, right, it's a beautiful prayer. It's a good model for us. He declares who God is, right? He starts off almost reminding God, but I think more he's reminding himself and the people who are with him. He's reminding them how powerful God has shown himself to be for the people of Judah in keeping his promise to Abraham and bringing his people up out of Egypt and into this promised land, how he's protected them and watched over them, provided for them. He's kept them safe. But then Jehoshaphat begins to remind God of what God had told those people, the Israelites, concerning these nations that have now come against them. When the Israelites came up out of Egypt, God told the Israelites not to fight against, not to invade the Moabites or the Ammonites or the area where the Meunites came from. And somehow, miraculously, remember when we were back in Exodus and Numbers this fall? I know I'm going back before Advent, so that's a long way to remember. But remember how many times in those stories God told the people to do something, they didn't do it, right? All through Exodus and Numbers. But somehow miraculously, when you read in light of that, when it came to the Moabites and the Ammonites, the Israelites listened to God. They obeyed his command. They didn't attack or destroy the Moabites and the Ammonites. But despite all of that, Jehoshaphat tells God, now those nations that they left alone are coming and attacking them. And God asks, or Jehoshaphat asks God to judge those nations. He prays one of my favorite lines of prayer in all of the Old Testament. There at the end of his prayer, he says, God, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. We don't know what to do, he told God, but our eyes are on you. That's a great prayer to pull out anytime you're facing a situation that seems uncertain. God, we don't know what to do in this situation, but we're fixing our eyes on you and trusting that you do. And then the people waited, right? Chronicles said that the people of Judah stood there, the men, the women, the children, even the little ones. It's for you, Trey, the little ones. They stood there and waited to see how God was going to respond. And I wonder, you know, sometimes when we're reading stories like this in Scripture, we jump right from one verse to the next verse, right from one sentence to the next, and there's only, you know, a period, a paragraph break, and then the next one starts. I wonder how long the Israelites stood there waiting to hear God, waiting to see what God was going to say to them. Then in verse 14, it says, then God sent his spirit on a Levite named Jehaziel, and he prophesied to the people. Jehaziel told him, he said, don't be afraid and don't be discouraged. This battle isn't yours to fight. This is God's battle. He told him to go out and face him tomorrow, but you don't have to figure out how to defeat these armies. All you have to do is stand firm, and God will deliver you. That's as far as Will read in the story. If we were to continue, we'd find out that Jehoshaphat and all the people fell down in worship of God after hearing what Jehaziel had told them. And the next day, they went out as God had told them. And in believing what God had told them through Jehaziel, Instead of just sending the army out, at the head of the column of the marching army, they put the choir. They appointed people to sing, and they stuck them right out there in front of the army as they marched. And as they marched, they were singing, and they were worshiping, and they were praising God. And as they worshiped on their way, God struck the armies into a confusion, and he caused them to destroy one another. And the army of Judah, instead of getting involved in the fight, just went in and picked up the plunder without ever needing to draw a sword. It's an amazing story. It's a great reminder to us that the battles that we face are ultimately God's battles to fight. Sometimes he asks us to step in and fight, right? Like God led David to do when the Israelites were camped there opposite of the Philistines, and they kept marching out Goliath, and none of the Israelite soldiers would step forward. God led David to step up and fight. But sometimes, maybe I'd even say often, God just calls us to fix our eyes on him, to wait for his instructions, and to watch God deliver us. As I was thinking about this story that God led me to for this message in the context of this series on prayer and fasting, I began to wonder about Jehoshaphat's calling of a fast. It almost seems just like a tack on to the story, right? It talks about how they're going to seek God in prayer. We hear this beautiful, eloquent prayer that Jehoshaphat prays. Oh, and by the way, you know, Jehoshaphat called for a fast too. Well, was it the fasting that got God's attention? Or was it the prayer that Jehoshaphat and the others were praying that made the difference? The more I thought about it, the more I chewed on it and prayed about it, the more I realized that the answer was yes. Yes to both questions. Because I realized that the two are really inseparable. Right? And fasting is the physical, bodily expression of the desperation that we hear in Jehoshaphat's prayer. They resolved to seek the Lord. And that meant seeking God with every part of themselves, spiritually in prayer, physically in fasting. The people were directing every intention of their being toward God. What we do with our bodies matters, right? And there are times when we need to choose to express the intentions of our heart through our bodies, through a physical action, right? So there are times like this morning when we stood to worship God as a sign of respect and acknowledgement of the one in whose presence we stand. And there are times even when we may leave our place in the pew, right? Walk down to the altar and kneel in prayer. It's not that God can somehow hear us better here at the altar than he can if we're sitting 10 or 15 or 30 feet away. But we're using our bodies to bring our whole being into a unified alignment, bowing not just in our hearts before the Lord, but in our very physical reality. Then there are times when the sacred significance of the situation in which we find ourselves is such that it calls for a unified response of our whole being, right? And so we fast. As we pray, we set aside the physical nourishment that our bodies need in an acknowledgement that God is the only one who can meet the need that we are facing. Have you ever noticed how when people are grieving, when they're in the throes of shock and mourning and the finality of death, the natural physical response tends to be a loss of appetite? And it's in the midst of that loss of appetite that the church people bring over 47 casseroles, right? But I think there's something significant theologically there. I don't think it's just our desire to nurture those people. But while we recognize the sacred reality that that family is experiencing in those moments and days, the meals themselves are an unconscious reminder of God's provision in the face of that loss. Now, the story of Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah isn't the only place we see this kind of fasting in the face of a great need. In the book of Ezra, as the people, the Jewish people who were in exile in Babylon, were about to begin the return journey from Babylon back to Jerusalem, we read in Ezra 8:21, Ezra says, "There by the Ahava canal, I proclaimed a fast so that we might humble ourselves before God and ask him for a safe journey for us and our children with all of our possessions." See, Ezra and the exiles understood that God is the one who had granted them their return from exile. And it was only God who could see them safely returned to their homeland. Or if we looked at the book of Esther, when Haman's plot to wipe out the Jewish people was discovered, and Esther's uncle Mordecai was imploring her to go before the king on behalf of her people, after wrestling with it for a while, Esther said, "Go and gather all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go before the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." Esther knew that only God could make a way for her, and in making a way for her, make a way for her people. And so she called for them to seek God everything they were, with their entire being. Jehoshaphat, the people of Judah, Ezra and the returning exiles, Esther and the people of God, they found themselves in circumstances in which they recognized there was no strategizing their way out. And they recognized that they weren't powerful enough to secure a positive outcome in this situation. There was nothing they could do. They didn't know what they should do, so they put their eyes on God. They aligned their entire being, spirit, soul, and body, heart, mind, and will. They focused all of their intention on seeking God and his answer to the reality that they were facing. And then they waited and watched for God to deliver them. Friends, I don't know if you're facing this kind of a reality in your life or in your family today. I know some of you are. I know that means that there are others I don't know about. But I also know that we're facing this kind of reality as a church, right? As a congregation, as we seek a way to move into the future in faithfulness to who God has called us to be. And I'll be honest, we don't have the power to make a way for ourselves. The obstacles before us are too great for us to move on our own. And there's no strategy that we can work out that guarantees success or a positive outcome. But, we know where to fix our eyes. So I want to invite you to join me, to align your entire being, to seek God together as a congregation. With Jehoshaphat and Ezra and Esther, I'm calling for fasting and prayer, for God to move on our behalf, to make a way for us. If you were fasting during Advent in preparation for Christ's coming, as we talked about in our Prepare the Way series, that was just the warm-up, okay? However God would lead you to fast and pray in the coming days and weeks, I don't feel like we need to make a program where I tell you exactly when you should fast or what you should pray. You can work that out with God, whether that's, you know, one meal a week or a day a week or more, or, you know, medically you're not able to fast. It's okay, but I want to invite you. Would you join me in seeking God with all that we are and waiting to see how God fights our battle for us, how he chooses to deliver his people and the role he's calling us to play in that? And I think we need to start now. So I want to invite the worship team to come back up. And in a moment, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to worship team. I'm going to invite you to come back up. Then in a moment, we're going to sing. I'm going to pray, some order like that. And I just want to invite you. The altar is open this morning. If God is leading you to seek him together with us for what he wants to do, whether that's in our church situations, whether that's in your own family situations or your personal situations, whatever that is, if you need this morning to physically come and pray at the altar, kneel at the altar, stand at the altar if you can't kneel, you're invited to do so. I want to invite you to tell God that we're going to wait for him to make a way for us, because he's the only one who's able to make that way. He's the only one to tell us when we should move forward and in what direction. Let's pray together. God, we come before you today recognizing that there are situations in our lives where we are powerless. We don't have anything we can do. We need you to make a way for us. And so we're going to fix our eyes on you. When we don't know what to do, we're going to fix our eyes on you until you tell us what you want us to do. And then we're going to keep our eyes on you, and we're going to get about the work of doing it. But God, we come to you today with our whole selves, our whole being. We need to hear from you. We need you to lead us. We need you to guide us. We need you to make a way where there seems to be no way. So would you come and meet with us? Speak to us even now as we seek your face. You're invited to stand, you're invited to sit, you're invited to come and pray, however God's leading you this morning.
Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. Oh, I will follow for you. I will wait for you on your word. I will rely and I will wait for you. Surely wait for you till my soul is satisfied. So put your hope in God alone. Take courage in His power to save. Completely and forever won by Christ emerging from the grave. Oh, I will wait for you. I will wait for you on your word. I will rely and I will wait for you. Surely wait for you till my soul is satisfied. Himself has paid the price that all who trust in Him today find healing in His sacrifice. That all who trust in Him today find healing in His sacrifice. Oh, I will wait for you. I will wait for you.
Lord, in your mercy, would you hear our prayers? Lord, would you help us? Through the storm, through the night, through whatever it is we're walking through, would you help us to fix our eyes on you? Would you help us to trust you? Would you help us to rely on your word to us? God, would you help us as a church to be faithful to all that you've called us to be? To be ready to move when you say move, to be ready to stay when you say stay, to be ready to do whatever you're asking us to. God, we want to seek you. We're going to wait for you. So would you speak to us? Thank you that we don't have to wait for your spirit to come on someone. Your spirit has already been placed inside of us. So God, would you speak to us? As a whole congregation, God, would you speak to us? Help us to know without a shadow of a doubt where you're leading, what you're asking of us, so that we can move forward into a faithful future. Trusting in you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, would you receive benediction this morning? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in grace and go in peace this morning. Amen.
Yeah, I will wait for you. I will wait for you through the storm.